All right, it's 7 o'clock, so let's do it. I'm so excited and so thankful for SF Neon and the Tenderloin Museum for joining us for our final in our Summer Stride series. We have had the joy and pleasure of them joining us for 3 events, and this is our 3rd and final, and we are taking a trip through the cinematic journey of Neon in San Francisco. All right, and some library news. Like I said, this is part of our Summer Stride series. We have a few more events left on the adult side. And speaking of adults, Summer Stride is not just for kids, it's for all ages. So sign up, you can still sign up and get your tote bag. So do that 20 hours reading, get your tote bag at any of your local branches or main library. All right, we have a new land acknowledgement. So forgive me if I screw it up. Here we go. The San Francisco Public Library acknowledges that we occupy the unceded ancestral homeland of the Ramaytush Ohlone people, who are the original inhabitants of the San Francisco Peninsula. We recognize that the Ramaytush Ohlone understand the interconnectedness of all things and have maintained harmony with nature for millennia. We honor the Ramaytush Ohlone people for their enduring commitment to WAREP, Mother Earth. As indigenous protectors of this land and in accordance with their traditions, the Ramaytush Ohlone have never ceded, lost, nor forgotten their responsibilities as caretakers of this place, as well as for all people who reside in their traditional territory. We recognize that we benefit from living and working on their traditional homeland. As uninvited guests, we affirm their sovereign rights as First Peoples and wish to pay our respects to the ancestors, elders, and relatives of the Ramaytush community. We recognize to respectively honor Ramaytush peoples, we must embrace and collaborate meaningfully to record indigenous knowledge and how we care for San Francisco and all its people. And I will be putting a link in a chat box that has lots of reading lists and resources to First Persons and Ramaytush culture. We have a reading campaign called On the Same Page. It's a bi-monthly read. In July and August, we're celebrating the work of Jacqueline Woodson. Pick up this book at your local library. You'll see them sitting there, all on display, waiting to be picked up. On Sunday, we will be featuring the amazing work of Redessa Jones. And this aligns with San Francisco Public Library's Jail and Reentry Services Department. And Redessa has been teaching art and transformation in women's prisons. So please come out for this important event. And after Summer Stride, we're gonna slide right into BIVA, Latinx Heritage Month, full of authors, full of poets. And I cannot wait, it's gonna be fun. We are even having in-person events, get ready. So stay tuned for that. And our On the Same Page for September and October is the Undocumented Americans, and you can pick that up. And Carla Cornejo Villavicencio will be in conversation with Jonathan Blitzer on October 26th. All right, and now without further ado, I want to again thank the Tenderloin Museum, San Francisco Neon, for joining us for this final in a 3-part series, which you can catch all of them on YouTube. I want to thank Katie Conry of the Tenderloin Museum, and Al Barna and Randall Ann Homan for just bringing this all together for us this summer. And then a huge shout out to historian and librarian, Secret Society librarian, Jim Van Buskirk for being here tonight. And I shall turn it over. Whoops. You're not supposed to see that. There we go.
Here we are. Well, thank you for having us. We feel really lucky to be working with SFPL.
And happy to be here tonight. Thanks for joining us, everyone.
And so we've got a great team with Katie and Jim. So we'll start our slideshow. Now that you've seen us big, we're going to turn into matchbook size and show you some great clips of San Francisco in the movies. Okay. Let's see if I can do this without messing it up.
There we go. It looks great.
Okay, great. Looks great. Well, this is the green glow of neon, and this is from the movie Vertigo, which we're going to talk about at length later. But first, a word about us. And let's see if I can do this.
I bet you can.
There we go. This has been an amazing partnership with Katie, and she's going to tell you about it.
Hello, I'm Katie Connery, the executive director of the Tenderloin Museum. Thanks very much for having me this evening. The Tenderloin Museum opened in 2015 with the mission of uncovering the lost history of the Tenderloin, as well as celebrating the vibrant present-day community. And we do that through historical exhibitions, an art gallery, walking tours, and weekly public programming. And we are currently open 10 to 5 Tuesday through Sunday, with walking tours of the neighborhood at 1 p.m. on Saturdays. So come by and see us soon. And the Tenderloin Museum is the fiscal sponsor of San Francisco Neon and our long-term collaborators and friends. And we have worked together on art shows, public programming, walking tours, and we have an initiative with the city of San Francisco to restore neon signs in the Tenderloin neighborhood called Tenderloin Neon A to Z. So without further ado, I'll turn things back over to San Francisco Neon.
Okay, and we will be skipping all over the city with this presentation, but we've got a couple of films that are definitely include the Tenderloin neighborhood, and we've always got our radar out for Tenderloin history.
That's right.
All right, so
anything we learn, we pass it on to Katie.
Right, and you're Al Barna, right?
I am Al Barna.
I'm Randall Ann Homan, and Al's gonna kick off the first film.
Okay, I think we're ready to go. Well, no, we're not quite ready to go yet. One of the reasons we're here is because of these two books. Celluloid San Francisco was written by Jim Van Buskirk and Will Shank. A great, definitive, excellent, knowledgeable compilation of cinema locations in San Francisco. It was a book that we leaned on heavily in our early days of compiling neon information, long before we actually knew Jim as anything but an author. His book was instrumental for us in getting our book, San Francisco Neon, off the ground. Wouldn't you say?
Yeah, and so San Francisco Neon is a photography book of all the, we think, over 200 beautiful neon signs in San Francisco. It's still available. We'll tell you more about how to get it later, but it is in every branch library. So how cool is that, that the library includes this book in all of the branches?
Yeah, which was a great honor for us when the library purchased this book for all the branches, wasn't it?
All right, so that's the book. We got to start with books for a library gig, right?
That's right. What better place? All right, but let's get the show started. I'm going to take you into the world of film noir here with our first look at an Orson Welles film from 1947 called The Lady from Shanghai. It's a visually stunning film noir, but it had such a complicated plot that Columbia Pictures boss Harry Cohn offered a reward to the person who could actually explain to him what in the world was going on in this movie. But that being said, it's a convoluted plot, but it was really inventive cinematography. If you haven't seen the movie, it's a must-see. And if you live in San Francisco, it's even more of a must-see. So we're going to show a clip from that movie of Orson Welles on a narcotic stumble through Chinatown as he tries to shake a frame-up and a femme fatale, who in this case is a blonde Rita Hayworth. So let's follow Orson through the streets of Chinatown.
And this is an amazing look at what Chinatown looked like in 1947.
All right, here we go.
Watch it.
All right. Not only did you hear two Chinese dialects in that clip, you also heard a little smattering of Japanese as well.
Going on in that clip.
Right. And all of the signage and the neon signage in that clip just lends itself to the tapestry of fear and chaos and mystery that this whole movie is about. So great use of locations by Orson Welles and his crew. And we could talk about the signs in that scene for the rest of the evening, but we'll just focus on one or two here. For instance, behind Orson Welles in the still image on the left, you see the chop suey sign. That's called a vertical sign because it's a vertical orientation to the building. It was the old Shanghai Lo, which was one of the earliest restaurants on Grand Avenue. And the photo on the right is taken a few years ago. And that's the same sign, the same tin can, which is what the cabinet of the sign is called. It's sign maker slang for the cabinet is tin can. But you can see, if you look close, it says Lotus Garden. In the 70s, it became a vegetarian restaurant, a very popular vegetarian Chinese restaurant. And for a while, it even served kosher. So it was popular with tour buses from all over the Bay Area. And the sign is still there. It would be great to see it restored one of these days.
And it's what do we figure, 74 years old?
At least 74 years old, because that's when the movie was made in 47. So that places that sign, you got to figure it was already on the building then. So it could be 84 years old.
And it's amazing. These signs are made of really good metal, which is why they last.
Right. Sheet metal. Now, here you see the Lipo Lounge. In its fully restored glory in the photo on the right. On the left is a still from the movie where Rita Hayworth is on Grand Avenue pursuing or looking for Orson Welles. And you see the same sign behind her. That is a rear projection, but the sign, it gives you an idea of the age of this sign. And Randall and I were really proud to be associated with the restoration of this sign.
Let's ask a question. Rita Hayworth wasn't really at Lipo's, but how many of you guys out there have actually been to Lipo's? That'd be fun to find out. And who's had a Chinese Mai Tai?
Yeah, if you haven't had a Chinese Mai Tai, maybe haven't been to Lipo.
But let's talk about the sign, sorry.
Okay, so you see, we tried to stay with traditional colors. That's the consultation we gave, was to go with traditional colors based on old photographs and other people's knowledge of the sign from past decades. Let's see what our next slide has here.
I think it's the next movie.
We don't want to do that. Okay. Well, there you have it. You can see pure neon tubing and the orange glow in the trim. That's all pure neon and clear glass tubing. The yellow, the Lipo, is what's known as Nobile gold glass. Mm-hmm. That's very expensive glass imported from Italy. The green arrow is colored glass called emerald green, and the word cocktails was done in a phosphor coated blue.
No, that's pure argon gas rather than neon gas.
That's pure argon. All right, that's argon, pure argon in clear glass. One of the tricks to make argon glow a little brighter than it does in its natural electrified state is to add a drop of mercury to the tubes when they're vacuum sealed. That mercury tends to brighten up the color blue in the argon gas.
All right, so that's our look at Chinatown. So let's go to another part of town now. Thieves Highway is a real action film based in the produce market. And it's really is just a great film. Recommend everybody see it. Richard Conte and Valentina Cortesa and Lee J. Cobb do some great performances. And this is a movie that is, in fact, all about the price of apples. And this gives you a little look at how busy the produce market was down near the Embarcadero Cerros are now, at the foot of Washington and Clay Street. And almost all of the trading happened in the late night, early morning hours. And it was a pretty rough and tumble scene. And if you take a look at, this is the movie, what the movie looks like. And then we've got a great photo from the San Francisco History Center, the library. This is what it actually looked like. And what's so also so amazing is that they filmed it on location. And so this movie also just becomes a wonderful documentation of what the produce market looked like. But let's get to the romance of this movie. And these are star-crossed lovers, and they are out for a walk, and they live at the Colchester Hotel, which was a very real place. And as you see in this clip, this neon sign really becomes a watchful character in this little piece of drama. So let's watch them do their things. And I hope for the best for these two.
I often walk here. I like those noises.
You don't care about the noises. You like to walk here because in a spot like this, you can be yourself.
What am I?
You're not the dame who was handing me that stuff back at Shorty's. You're just a scared kid.
Oh, no.
Look, you hang around crummy joints, you stay up all night, you know a slug named Figley. Who do you think you're fighting? You're only taking it out on yourself. What's breaking you up? What's so funny?
Oh, isn't that sweet? He wants to save me. Go ahead, lover. Tell me what a bad girl I am. Goodbye, lover.
This is all one take. And you can see he really is. It's being filmed right in front of the Colchester Hotel. It's not a Hollywood set, which I think makes this film particularly fascinating. And also just the way the Colchester Hotel neon sign is just watching over these two through the whole scene and actually through the whole movie. Here's another great historic photo from the Library's History Center. And there we see the Colchester Hotel again. And if you're wondering how, what you said this so great, how enmeshed the produce market was with this part of the waterfront full of hotels, this hotel also doubled as a potato warehouse.
Right, most of the ground floor was a potato warehouse.
Yeah, and this was knocked down just a couple of years after the film was made.
Right, maybe 3 or 4 years later, the city condemned the building as a health hazard. You can see some of the cracks in the brick facade on the second story.
Not good. But the other thing I love about this photo is that waterfront food market is just so classic. I love that this was captured in the Thieves' Highway. It really is a must watch. Okay, next up, we're going to go to a different part of town with the man who cheated himself, Lee J. Cobb's big lead role, and he is in trouble from the get-go. And so we're going to watch, this is a very noir film, as you can tell, of this dark, shadowy view of the Golden Gate Bridge. And that really is the focus of the scene. The bridge becomes a character, but not only that, the neon signage on the toll booth. This is the symbolism part of our program. So we're going to take a look at this. And Lee J. Cobb has that watchful neon clock telling him he's out of time. And the stop pay toll is telling him that crime does not pay. He's not paying attention to any of this symbolism. He's going to go right across the Golden Gate Bridge. And he has every chance to stop at this toll booth, but he's not going to stop. There's even an accusatory neon arrow pointing at him, and he misses all the neon symbolism, and he just keeps going, even though the neon's telling him to stop. And this is one of my favorite scenes. In the background, you can see that neon clock on the Golden Gate Bridge is watching him to let him know he's out of time. And let's talk about that clock. We're both kind of fascinated with that neon clock.
Okay, the clock is 8 foot tall and with neon numerals. And it was originally installed in 1949. You see the photo of the installation on the left, by QRS Sign Company, which was a sign, one of the major sign neon sign companies in the city on the entire West Coast. They actually had their business offices in one of the levels of the Golden Gate Theater. Now, the original sign or clock was replaced by a modern mechanical replica in 2003. You know, decades of salt water and corrosion and moisture finally got to the original. The replica itself was removed in 2014 for restoration, and it was reinstalled in April of 2015, and it's still maintained today. So definitely one of the most iconic neon signs in the city. Again, it's not a sign, it's a clock, but I think for anybody returning to San Francisco, this is the first neon you see when you come into the city from the north.
And any criminal will remember it forever in there if they didn't heed the warning. But also, we got to thank the SF History Center, particularly Jeff, who helped us find these great photos. And you can see that the original clock was a dark color rather than a white color. So it's gone through some changes. All right, moving along to one of the most iconic movies about San Francisco, Vertigo. We're going to assume that almost everybody who's a fan of cinema has seen this movie by Alfred Hitchcock. Two big stars, James Stewart and Kim Novak, and let's see what they get up to. We'll run this clip.
And here we have Jimmy Stewart walking up Sutter Street following Judy in her trademark green dress. Green's a very significant color in this movie. He's following her up Sutter Street, and she's going into the old Empire Hotel, which today is known as the Vertigo Hotel. It's still there. And he sees her go in. And fortuitously for him, maybe not for Judy so much, he sees her open the window here on cue.
So he knows that she's right outside that P.
And there she is. So, you know, he knows exactly which room she was
in.
And
there, that was not made for the movie. That was the real Empire Hotel sign.
That's right. This was a location shot.
Which is just beautiful. But on the interior, this is a soundstage. And
that was done in Los Angeles.
They built that out, that neon lettering outside of it to create this incredible green glow in the hotel room. And so it really is such a significant part of this movie, that green glow where they're sort of in this romantic space together. And if you haven't seen the movie, or if you have, then you know that Judy does transform into another character, and we're going to watch that happen live right here.
I think that Bernard Herrmann's score really enhances the action in that scene, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah. So let's take a look at this ghostly, Judy becomes Madeline. And this was done so low tech, really just by putting filters, maybe even with Vaseline on it, to make her appear ghostly like an apparition. And as she comes closer, she cuts into focus. But really, it's the green glow of the neon in this room that gives this ambiance of this kind of magical transformation. And sometimes it's referred to as the green fog of Vertigo. And in fact, Jim tipped us off. There's an art film called The Green Fog, made by a Canadian filmmaker. Are we going to remember his name?
Guy Madden.
Which, if you're a fan of Vertigo, definitely take a look at that, because it really references how much other movies about San Francisco referenced this film. And he can't help himself but put green fog over many of the scenes. However, there's only a little bit of neon in the Green Fog movie. But it's quite an homage to this beautiful, beautiful film, Vertigo. And if you haven't seen Vertigo, well, lucky you. You can see it because it plays 24 hours
a day at the Vertigo Hotel on Sutter Street. So, you know, if you time it right, you can show up every other night and catch another 30 minutes or so of the film.
Yeah.
What a place to watch it.
All right. So that's the Vertigo portion. We're moving on to a movie that was made in San Francisco the same year, Pal Joey. And this is a lot of fun. And again, Kim Novak was, I guess, really hot that year. And this is another great look at a different part of town. This is the International Settlement, which is Pacific Street, just next to North, between North Beach and Chinatown. And it had been the famous Barbary Coast where all the shady nightclubs and Shanghais had been, but it was just kind of reimagined as an entertainment center. And what was the quote? It's a place that if you're on the loose, you can really get tight, right? Okay, so let's take a look at Pal Joey. This is a really fun Frank Sinatra vehicle and gives us a great look of what the street looked like in the late 50s.
Herm, you need a singer?
Singer? I don't care if you sing like a nightingale. I'm running a girl's show. Legs. Not tonsils.
I see what you mean.
Okay, so taking a look at the International Settlement, all those neon signs were there. But one we're particularly interested in, and that is this giant dancing leg of a can-can dancer. And it really has quite a history in the city. And because of Pal Joey, we know exactly what it looked like lit up. I love the neon folds of the skirts. We love the fancy V. And then the Barbary Coast is written in incandescent bulbs, not neon, but the leg itself is all neon. And we've got one more clip so we can see Frank Sinatra making the rounds on the same street at night. And this part of town was really on its last legs. They kind of spruced it up for the movie. And all these neon signs were just taken down and destroyed during the City Beautiful era of, that was Lady Bird Johnson's campaign to clean up all the old, you know, basically clean up Main Street, get rid of all the old dead neon signs.
And also at this time, by the late 50s, International Settlement was really suffering from competition from North Beach, and Broadway, racier shows, swanker nightclubs, jazz clubs were really popular in North Beach. So at this point in time, the International Settlement was pretty much in its last hurrah.
Yeah, and they took down the International Settlement sign, but one sign definitely survived. And there you see the Chez Paris in the Tenderloin. This is from The Laughing Policeman. The Chez Paris moved to Mason Street. And we wondered, for a long time, is this the exact same sign that was on the International Settlement on Pacific Street? We took a look at this great, again, another great historic photo from the History Center. There you see the International Settlement arch lit up, and there's the Barbary Coast sign behind it. And so we'll zoom in on this and show you a little bit of our neon detective work. We took a really close look at this photo that Al took in the 70s of the Chez Paris. And the closer we looked, the more we could see that there were little holes for the incandescent bulbs. And so, in fact, underneath the word Chez Paris were little holes that spelled out Barbary Coast. So that tells us, in fact, it is the exact same sign that left Pacific Street and moved to Mason. Now, where is that sign now? Rumors abound.
And, you know, it actually at one point was installed across the street on Mason Street from that location in my photograph. So
that's right. So it's been on two different places on Mason Street. And the theater is still there. But now it has, I believe, a neon martini glass on top.
Yeah, it's a sports bar.
Right. Okay, so one last look at this beautiful dancing leg. We'd love to see this back up in the Tenderloin someday. It's hard to believe that it's really gone. It may surface, we hope so. All right, so another part of town, and we're going to turn it over to Jim Van Buskirk.
Thanks, Randall. Yeah, we're back in Chinatown now with Flower Drum Song. And this is based on Rodgers and Hammerstein's 1958 Broadway musical, which is based on Chin Yang Lee's 1957 novel, Flower Drum Song. And this Universal Studios production was the first major Hollywood feature to have a majority Asian American cast in a contemporary Asian American story. Unfortunately, Flower Drum Song is reportedly the only Hollywood adaptation of a Rodgers and Hammerstein musical to lose money. Let's look at a clip from the film. Randall will cue it in a second. There she goes. So I'll talk over this. So this is from the film, but this is actually footage from the 1961 San Francisco Chinese New Year parade. It turns out that only a few scenes were actually filmed on location. And you'll see as we watch this, that it's intercut with soundstage reaction shots. And look at all the neon. We figure that about 90% of these beautiful neon signs are gone. And of the cast, Nancy Kwan is the only lead to be ethnic Chinese. She is mixed race with a European mother. Several members of the cast, original cast, appear in the film, including Miyoshi Umeki and James Shigeta, both of whom are Japanese American. Juanita Hall, who's African-American, Patrick Adiarte, who's Filipino-American. And Jack Su, who was born Suzuki, was elevated from his stage role of nightclub MC to the leading role of club owner. Okay, now we have audio in this clip. Hopefully.
Street with eastern manners, tall pagodas and golden banners throw their shadows through the lantern glow.
You can shop for precious jade or teakwood tables or silk brocade
or see a bold and brassy nightclub show
on the most exciting thoroughfare I know. Grant Avenue, San Francisco, California, USA. Looks down from Chinatown over a foggy bay.
You travel there in a trolley,
up you climb.
Dong, dong, you're in Hong Kong, having yourself a time.
And so you can see that this is now a set recreated at three-quarter size. It apparently cost $310,000. And so I don't think Nancy Kwan was ever filmed in San Francisco. And those tacky costumes are by renowned Hollywood designer Irene Sharaf. And I think the choreography is terrible. It's by Hermes Pan. So the feel of the street is recreated, even if not any actual neon signs. And now, guess who's coming to dinner? This was the ninth and final on-screen pairing of Katharine Hepburn and Spencer Tracy. Filming ended just 17 days before Tracy's death. And the first clip, which Randall is going to cue up. So there's very little location filming, as with Flower Drum Sign, and none with Hepburn and Tracy. This is going to be rear screen projection down Mission to the Mels that was way out past Geneva in the Excelsior. So we're going down Mission Street, heading south, and you can see it's all rear screen projection, which was Hollywood's magical way of making us think that Hepburn and Tracy were actually in San Francisco. And then they're going to turn into Mel's, which is a different Mel's than the American Graffiti. And it will have been stand-ins for this shot. And then here's another rear screen projection, this time down Market Street. And here we see the young lovers, Sidney Poitier and Catherine Houghton, with Roy E. Glenn Sr. and Bea Richards portraying Poitier's parents. And this film won 10 Oscar nominations, including Best Picture, Best Director, Tracy, Hepburn, and Bea Richards. So don't miss that Embassy Theater neon sign. I was interested to learn that interracial marriage was illegal in 14 states until the Supreme Court decision Loving versus Virginia in June of 1967. And this film was released in December of 1967. So it was pretty controversial for its time. And obviously almost all of that neon down Market Street is now gone. But it's amazing how the cinematographer has used it as a stunning backdrop to this, this four-hander scene. And I'm up again. This is Dirty Harry. Don Siegel directed this as renegade police inspector Harry Callahan, and Clint Eastwood went on to star in 4 sequels. So the first clip is going down Broadway. Filming for Dirty Harry began in April 1971. So in distinction to the last two films I talked about, a lot, almost all of the film was shot on location. And look at the play of the Broadway signs, including some neon on the car windshield. And what a wonderful documentation of what Broadway looked like in 1971. The killer, called Scorpio, was inspired by the Zodiac Killer, and the story was originally set in New York City and then another draft in Seattle before it was located in San Francisco. So the next slide is a still of the Jesus Saves sign, and I couldn't remember that sign. It's on the Blue Shield building of Stockton Street at Columbus. So watch this sequence and see how it's used. It was built and installed specifically for the film by art director Dale Hennessy. And I found an article by Stanley Eichelbaum in the Examiner and Chronicle. Clint Eastwood said, it's very tricky and very physical. And Siegel said, and we can't work past midnight because the gunfire would disturb the neighborhood people. neighborhood. People have already complained about the neon sign, although it's hard to know why it offends them. He explained that the Jesus Save signs has no special significance. We needed something to draw interest to this roof when we shift attention to the killer. The floodlit background is also important since we focused attention on various apartments to show people's reaction to this shooting. But the San Francisco scenery is worth all the trouble. Clint and I felt it would be better to make the picture here in San Francisco. And that's because I'm from here, said San Francisco born and Oakland raised Eastwood. And then this is a very quick sequence of the Scorpio killer staggering into Park Emergency Hospital at 811 Stanyan at Haight. And that neon is no longer with us either. So I think it's back to you. And
okay, Jim, thank you so much for that, for the 70 films. And we've got one more 74 film we couldn't resist putting in because it's just, well, you can tell from this logo, Freebie and the Bean was not a serious movie. And maybe kind of a spin-off of Dirty Harry. It's just one of these San Francisco cop movies, of which there were many, like The Laughing Policeman. And this one is just so silly, but it does show some great neon, particularly the Omar Khayyam restaurant. And there's also just kind of a hilarious.
So this is the opening
sequence. This is the opening sequence with just a song to wake you right up. All right. We're not going to show you any clips from this movie because you've seen almost all the neon that's in Freebie and the Bean. But what a great depiction of Omar Khayyam. It was a beautiful neon marquee and also a great one of the first Armenian restaurants in the city. So that's a little San Francisco history.
And there's the behind Omar Khayyam's is, or past Omar Khayyam's is the Barron's saloon, which is long gone now.
We'll see that, then we'll see that later, right?
Yeah.
Okay, and another
clip.
All right, we're going to let Katie do this next film and just take it away.
Yeah, now we're going to turn our attention to a film that's very near and dear to my heart, Invasion of the Body Snatchers, 1978. And this film is the only horror film featured this evening. And it really does an amazing job at capturing San Francisco in the late 70s, including some great shots of the Tenderloin. So let's take a look at one of the film stills. This is a capture from Real SF. And you can see this beautiful neon sign and this phenomenal ringside script. And does anyone know what location this is? You can let me know in the chat if you would like to. Anyone? Okay. All right, well, next slide. That's right, it's the Tenderloin Museum. This is the exact storefront location where the Tenderloin Museum is today. And it's actually featured in quite a key scene. So we're gonna play a clip starring Brooke Adams and Donald Sutherland. And make sure to take note of the screaming man played by Kevin McCarthy, who was the lead protagonist in the original version of 1956 Invasion of the Body Snatchers. So he has a really meaningful cameo in the remake from 78. And this clip is also just a great snapshot of Eddie and Leavenworth in 1978.
Listen, help me, you're next, please, you're next, we're in danger, please, listen to me, something terrible, please, you're next, here they are, they're already here, help, you're next, they're coming.
I must have done something. The policeman will help.
So if you haven't seen this movie, I highly recommend it. It features three of my favorite actors, Leonard Nimoy, Donald Sutherland, and Jeff Goldblum. It's hugely entertaining, and it has incredible location shots of San Francisco in the 70s.
And that gives us a great look at the corner where the Tenderloin Museum is. We love this one. All right, we are rolling right along, and Al's going to take you back to Chinatown.
Okay, yeah, back to Chinatown for a short look at Chan is Missing. This movie really provides a pretty stark counterpoint to Flower Drum Song, which Jim ran for us a little earlier. In a 1983 review by Roger Ebert, he wrote that the title, Chan is Missing, is almost a pun because the Charlie Chan Chinese stereotype that had been created by Hollywood over numerous decades is missing completely from this film. Wayne Wang was the director, producer, editor, and co-author of Chan is Missing. He was only 33 years old when he did this film, and he did it on a budget of $22,000, which is pretty remarkable. So we're going to look at an extended clip. This clip's a little longer than what we've been showing so far tonight. You're about to see a great view of Chinatown, and accompanied by the same song that Nancy Kwan sang, Grand Avenue. This time it's performed by Pat Suzuki, who was actually considered for the lead in Flower Drum Song, but turned it down because she had just given birth to her son and was much more interested in being a mother to her son than she was in starring in Flower Drum Song. So let's take a look. Before we do though, just look at this. This photo's compressed view of Grand Avenue, but you just get a great idea of the incredible amount of signage in Chinatown. Now, some of these signs still exist. A lot of them are gone, but also you'll notice at this point in 1982, plexiglass and fluorescent lighting, backlit plexiglass signs were taking over. Neon was heyday had come and gone at that point, and was replaced with a much cheaper product, which was plexiglass and fluorescent tubing. So let's move on to the film.
We're back,
but I can't advance the slide.
I'll do it for you, but tell us about that sign.
Yeah, the chop suey sign that you see in the upper right of this photo, that sign is still there to this day. It does not light up, but it's a great little sign and gets quite a cameo in this movie. But more significantly, it's the last neon chop suey sign in all of Chinatown. So there you have it. You can see it's weathered and rusted extensively. Surprisingly enough, the glass is all in good shape, but you can see how the paint is peeling down actually to the bare metal of the cabinet itself.
It's so important when the tubes are still there in terms of restoration, because even if some of them are a little bit broken, we can take them off and trace them and remake them so they fit right back on the sign.
You can trace them onto a pattern, a paper pattern, which will be transferred to the metal.
And the rust can be cleaned off. It can be paint cleaned off. It can be repainted. And that's happened to a number of signs in Chinatown. I mean, people are really starting to value these great old signs and the feeling that they bring to the street.
Okay, let's move on.
Now Jim's up.
So here we go. This is a biopic of our beloved San Francisco supervisor, Harvey Milk, starring Sean Penn. In my research, I learned that Robin Williams was originally slated to star, and then Richard Gere, Daniel Day-Lewis, Al Pacino, and James Woods were all also considered. And the production and costume design teams conducted extensive research in the archives of the GLBT Historical Society and the SFPL San Francisco History Center, where the Harvey Milk Scott Smith archives are housed. And many actual filming locations include City Hall, Milk's original Castro camera store, and storefronts along a block of Castro Street were returned to their late 70s look. So let's look at the first short clip where we're going to see James Franco as Scott Smith looking out the window of Castro camera, watching Sean Penn, and look at the reflection of the liquor store neon sign across the street. Beautiful use of neon in this shot. Okay, and then the next sequence. So this is a silent piece showing the Castro Theater marquee, which had been restored for the filming, but old timers say that it was never actually that color. The marquee originally extended out over the street and was often hit by delivery trucks. After the sidewalk was widened, those collisions ceased, but so did repairs on the sign. So it's already showing signs of neglect since 2018. And Alan Sawyer reminded us that during the construction of the Castro Muni Underground Station, the plywood was often used as a makeshift stage. So the filmmakers covered over the station again to replicate its historical accuracy. And notice the next clip is going to have audio, which of course makes it much more dynamic. And it ends with a nice shot of the press people on the top of the marquee.
I know you're angry! I'm angry! Let's march the streets of San Francisco and share our anger!
So great shot of the restored marquee. And then this is another shot. We saw a glimpse of the Twin Peak Tavern just now. This will have no audio, so I can tell you that it first opened in 1935 at the corner of Castro and Market and was purchased by Mary Ellen Cunha and Peggy Forrester in 1972. The plate glass windows make it the first gay bar in history to feature full length windows that let the patrons look in, the patrons look out and the public look in. And the metal box sign is shaped to represent fog and the geographic Twin Peaks. The words Twin Peaks are both painted and outlined in neon tubing, and an additional outline of a martini glass has been appended to the sign. And those rainbow arrows animated by synchronized flashing light aim toward the commercial entry. So it's pretty spectacular way to mark the corner of that important intersection. Thanks, Randall.
You're welcome, Jim. Okay, we are in the home stretch. We've got one more film to show you. And I will pull together a list of these films and put them into the chat. But Al's gonna tell you about this next film, which is called—
Okay, our next and last film is Tim Burton's Big Eyes, which came out in 2014. It's the story of Margaret and Walter Keane. It's a sad story of Margaret and Walter Keane. It's basically about artists, con artists, art critics, and art snobs. And we're gonna look at three short clips from the movie And but all three of these clips will illustrate a significant development in filmmaking in the last 20 years.
Get ready.
Okay. And here we are in North Beach. This is near the opening of the movie. We're on Green Street. And you could see, so they shot on location, and they were able to use the signs for Gino and Carlo, the Columbus Cafe, which is fairly visible farther down the street. And they also did some wooden signs or hand-painted signs all around the neighborhood. One of them there was the Black Cat Cafe. So those were made for the movie, but they did utilize a lot of the existing signage in North Beach when they shot this film. So let's take a look at this first clip.
Where we see our art heroine, she lands in North Beach for a new life.
I think I missed, you can also see the Sodini's restaurant sign in the right-hand side. That was actually the old Green Valley restaurant, but they repurposed the lettering, kept the sign. You can tell which one's been living in San Francisco for 6 months.
And who's new in town. Amy Adams really does an amazing job in this film. And it's a very, very troubled marriage she finds herself in.
You don't want to give any of the films away if you've actually seen it. All right, so this clip is... Margaret Keane. Well, she's not Margaret Keane yet, but she's about to accept a date at an art fair here in Washington Square Park. So let's take a look.
Mr. Albrecht is out of the picture.
All right, that's Powell Street in the 60s. And we'll get back to this in a little while, but I just wanted to take a good look at Powell Street. So this is right below Post, this would be at O'Farrell, looking up towards Post Street, up towards Knob Hill.
So do you want to talk about, I was going to mention the Chez Henri.
Yeah, that's actually done with CGI, and that is approximately where the Omar Khayyam's restaurant building is still located, that beautiful green ceramic tile building.
And didn't we see the Barons?
And Barons was visible in the Freebie and the Bean clip we showed. So Barons, and then you see Lefty O'Doul's, which actually that would have been its original location. But this, again, was all done with CGI. The only real neon signs in this still are the Chancellor Hotel, which is farther back on the left. And you can see a little bit of the Hotel Stratford sign. And there's a green martini glass in front of that from a little tourist trap bar. That exists, but everything else, like the Paddock, the Floria, Barons, and Lefties, that's all inserted with CGI.
I love that they actually put in the baseball above Lefties, which used to be there when Lefties was on Powell.
That's right. Okay, one more clip. We're on Broadway. Okay, well, when this movie came out in 2014, a lot of people told me, Al, you're going to love this film. There's so much neon. It's just great. So I went to see it, and I watched the movie and thought, yeah, there's a lot of neon. But researching the movie for this presentation really brought up some interesting points here. And let's go down Broadway. Let's start on our right here. You see Murio's Trophy Room sign, which if you're a San Franciscan, you know Murio's is on Haight Street.
Not Broadway.
Right. And there you see the famous lake from the Barbary Coast has been planted in this scene as well. And then right behind the plexiglass sign for the Barbary Coast, you see a brick sign painted on the brick wall for the Hotel St. Paul. Well, that exists, but it's actually on Jackson Street, Jackson off of Kearney in Chinatown.
A great ghost sign that still exists. Right.
And the Hungry Eye, that neon, that's just been inserted on the facade of that building. That's not there. And we go a little farther down the street. Maybe my favorite here is you see the Ha-Ra. which is on Geary at Larkin. So they might have inserted signs a little, you know, took some liberties here, but at least they're all San Francisco neon signs. And then even farther down, you can barely make out Carol Doda's, Carol Doda's rendering on the old Condor Club sign.
It's the famous sign that had the blinking lights for the nipples. But I just want to point out one thing that bugs me, even though they put the Ha Ra sign, and those that know, that love the Ha Ra and go there, you'll remember that the martini glass is above the H, not above the R. We have to notice these things.
Right. So we need to get on the art department, but it's a little late for that, I think. So,
but we're happy to consult for these kind of really important details, whoever's doing CGI neon signs next.
Right.
Someone's okay. All right. So let's see. I think that is our last film. And it is, in fact, we've got one more clip to show you, but before we open it up for questions, which we're excited to hear, I can see that there's a couple of questions. Two things coming up. Oh, well, of course, if you have room in your neon bookshelf, there are books. We love to publish books about neon, about San Francisco. And the Neon Icons book was a joint publication with the San Francisco Public Library. So that might be of particular interest to you guys. sfneon.org is where you can get these books. But really, we hope you will join us in September. We're doing a 4-day neon symposium and festival. We have people from all over the United States and Europe. We have people from Spain and Germany and also Canada. And we all get together and talk about the past, present, and future of neon, all online. And this is really a joint project with the Tenderloin Museum.
Yeah, this will be the 4th annual Neon Speaks.
Exactly. And we try to make it available to everybody. If you want an all event passport for free, go get it before September 1st. And we hope you join us for some of these dates and weekends. It's a whole lot of fun, and you're gonna learn a lot about neon and the culture that surrounds it, the small businesses.
We have a lot of really interesting presenters again this year. So,
but
we're excited about it.
And there's something even more exciting, or just as exciting, coming up right before Neon Speaks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, our 6th anniversary gala at the Phoenix Hotel is going to be September 9th from 5:30 to 8:30, and it's all outdoors. And we'll feature legendary San Francisco musician Leve Smith and her Red Hot Skillet Liquors, as well as some special surprise guests. So please consider supporting the Tenderloin Museum and purchasing a ticket.
And the Phoenix Hotel has a neon sign.
Yeah, it sure does.
This is a vintage photo from the Phoenix here.
We should have queued that up. All right, I think we may be ready for questions. Who's reading the question list?
I would be happy to. What's the oldest neon sign in San Francisco?
Well, it can be hard to date them because sometimes we are always looking for old film clips or old pictures. And that doesn't necessarily mean that Lipo is the oldest, but it's one of the most well-documented signs.
It is, but I tend to think that the oldest neon sign that I'm aware of just might be the Elm Hotel on Eddy Street, just around the corner from the Tenderloin Museum. If you look at the materials that it's made of and how it's fabricated, it's got what's known as ripple tin, and it's also studded. It's got like pop rivets instead of a
smooth weld.
Right. So that can be the oldest sign. However, it needs to be pointed out that just like cars, you can take parts from old signs and put them on new signs. So when you're looking at a piece of ripple tin, it doesn't necessarily mean that's from the original sign. It could be something that's being reused or repurposed. But my vote goes for the Elm Hotel.
Wow. One question is, are there any films showing the Mission's neon? And I actually do know that a George Cukor film called The Devil's Cleavage features an incredible shot of the 500 Club, both the outside sign and inside. So that's a pretty deep cut and not a Hollywood film, but there's that one. It's a great movie.
And there's an art film, I think it was, maybe Jim, you might pipe in, that really focuses on the 17 Reasons Why film. Do I have that right, Jim?
Yes, but I can't remember the name of it. And okay, well, we saw a lot of mission behind Spencer Tracy and Katharine Hepburn. I mean, it was quick and we didn't get to see a lot of it. But yeah, it's just amazing where it pops up when you're focused on the plot and not really paying attention to the neon.
Someone has a question about whether or not there will be a link to the recording sent out after. I believe there will be, and it will be up on the SFPL YouTube page. Could the chop suey sign be restored?
Go ahead.
It could. It would take some significant work. Like I say, the return on the sign, that's the spine piece, basically. It's called a return. It was pretty rusted out. I'm sure at this late date, the wiring and the transformer would need to be replaced. That's certainly doable. It could be repainted. The glass looked like it was in pretty good shape, and the glass could always be, new tubes can be bent to replace the old ones if they are broken or damaged in any way. So yes, that sign could be replaced. And importantly, when you've got the cabinet of the sign, you've got at least a leg to stand on in terms of restoration. And failing that, you can always do a replication of the sign. If you've got all the
completely trashed, you can often take parts of it. And it's usually the bottom of the sign that rusts out because the water collects if it doesn't have proper drain holes that let the water run through. And so sometimes it's actually that spine or the return of the sign that can be reconstructed, but the faces will stay in pretty good shape.
Yeah, most of the time.
Well, we have a number of questions about some signs kind of all in the same area. There was a wonderful coffee sign just as you come off the Bay Bridge. Was that neon? What happened to the old Burgermeister and Ham's Beer, Neon Wonders? And then another question about the Coca-Cola sign.
That's a lot there.
Okay, and we're big fans of all of these signs, and they are so iconic. I'm going to start with the first one, which is the coffee sign that you see when you come off the Bay Bridge. It's still there. It was restored by John Law and Paul Troutman. John Law keeps that in great working shape. We actually got to go up and see his work up close and personal. I was pretty terrified to be up that high, but it is an iconic sign of San Francisco, and so thankful that the building owners keep it in great working order. Right. You want to do the hands?
Well, wait.
Okay.
On the Hills Brothers, there was the painted coffee drinker that was also part of that sign. It was mounted on the building. My understanding from years ago is that went to the Hills Brothers headquarters in Los Angeles. And what they've done with it, I have no idea. And I'm talking, that was probably 20 some years ago when that was shipped out. And the Ham's Brewery, well, that sign is long gone. The brewery closed in the late 70s. And in 1985, the sign was removed. The building is now used for office space. And that was quite a sign. It went up in 1954. And when it went up, it was the largest commercial sign west of Chicago. It was such a big deal that they had the mayor of San Francisco at the time come out and flip the switch to turn it on. And there was another, the Coca-Cola sign. It's gone. We, Katie and I and Randall, know somebody who owns the letter C from that sign. Not sure what they're ever going to do with it because it's enormous. But that sign, unfortunately, before it was taken down, it had been converted to LED. So it hadn't been neon for quite a few years. Nevertheless, LED, it was a great sign, and it was a kinetic sign. It's what you call, in the sign industry, is known as a spectacular, where you've got flashing lights and movement. Those are called spectacular. So that was the only spectacular left in San Francisco, and of course, it's gone now.
We're running a little short on time, but let's do two more questions. Is there any neon in the film Bullet?
There is, but it goes by so fast. So it's really fun to watch. And that kind of lets us talk about why we picked the films we picked, is when we wanted to pick films where the neon is actually doing some work in the film, where the cinematographer has used it for a particular purpose. And it doesn't just happen to be in the background. And of course, the great example is the Jesus Save sign, which they built to become the background at night. And in crime films and in noir films, so much of the action happens at night in shadow. Sometimes it's the neon sign is the only clue that kind of places the action. And so it's wonderful for cinematographers in that style of movie.
So one last question, when is San Francisco neon going to start walking tours?
As soon as it's safe to go outside.
And who knows when that'll be.
One thing that really impacts us, and it's a good thing, there's so many now outdoor eating areas, parklets, where we used to stand and look at signs. So every single one of the five tours that we used to do in the city, we're going to have to reroute a little bit to accommodate that. And also, sadly, some of our most beloved and iconic eateries and bars have closed, most notably It's Tops. We used to always start our Mission Market Castro tour there. And so we've got to rethink some of those walks a little bit, but right. We miss them. We really miss being in the city at twilight, walking around with really interesting people like you guys. So we want to do them again, but it's going to be 2022.
I think on some of those tours, we learn more about neon from our audience than they learn
from
us.
And we learn about San Francisco history from the people on tours.
And it might sound like a small issue, but standing in the proper spot to talk about a sign and have people admire a sign is really strategic. And we actually map out our tours and spend a lot of time arguing with each other about where's the best place to stand. So there's more, we do put a lot of thought into that. And the parklets have definitely impacted that. So,
but when we come back and do walking tours again, we're going to try and bring Katie and Jim with us because it's been so much fun
on every tour
to work with them. And we've done a couple of tours with Katie in the Tenderloin, and we'll bring Jim Van Buskirk into the mix.
And
that's something for y'all to look forward to.
Jim has been on every one of our tours.
I miss doing them in person so much, but we are able to reach a lot more people this way. We can't have 150 people walking around on the sidewalk, city streets. So that is nice.
It's a big trade-off.
One plug as part of the upcoming Neon Symposium, some of our colleagues are doing a New York cinematic neon. So we're excited. I'm excited to see what they come up with and to see how neon is used in New York films compared to the ones we've seen tonight.
And that'll be presented by Tom Rinaldi, who is the author and photographer of the New York Neon book, which is awesome. And also Rolando Pujol, who has a great Instagram feed, if you look up Rolando Pujol, of just Americana roadside all over the country. He's
excellent photographer, excellent writer,
and
highly recommend
his and tireless driver around the country.
He's the kind of guy who will cross from Manhattan into New Jersey to run an errand and end up in Columbus, Ohio.
Yeah.
He's pretty remarkable that way.
So that is going to be a great cinematic neon presentation. So, and there are many more interesting events. We're so excited about Neon Speaks, where we do a lot of talking about San Francisco, but we also get let people talk about other parts of the country who have amazing landmark neon legacy and history.
Yeah, and interesting projects going on. So please join us. And I think it's time to thank everybody.
Yeah.
I'd like to thank Anissa and Lisa from the San Francisco Public Library. Thank the audience for attending. It's great to get so many people on these tours. And I'd like to thank Katie Connery from the Tenderloin Museum. And last but certainly not least, we'd like to thank Jim Van Buskirk for all the hard work he put into this whole series we did of Cinematic Neon. And we also would like to extend a huge thank you to Alan Sawyer for all of his sage advice and critiques and interesting comments about everything we've been doing through this whole project. So thanks to everyone.
Now, I just put in our email address in the chat because, of course, I can't come up with a list of films right this minute. But if you copy that and email me, I will send it to you. And it is a great list.
We have definitely put all of the films in this document that we've shared with everyone here many, many times. It's all there. Everything from not just this event, but the past two events with SF Neon. And then we also want to give a shout out. Unfortunately, we ran into some copyright issues tonight on YouTube. So some of our film clips got nixed and then it would pop back up. So I will send a link for the Zoom presentation out to all of the registered attendees, but we'll have to keep that in mind for future presentations. That is serious technology on YouTube.
Yeah, well, you never know, but this is what happens. Do we have time to go out with a 2-minute film?
Let's do it. Let's end it. All right, friends. Thank you all. Thank you, Katie, Al.
Thank you.
Randall Ann. Thank you so much. And Jim, we always love having you.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
Thanks very much.
So did you want to say something about this before we roll it?
Well, this references some of what Jim was talking about earlier in the night scene or the driving scene in Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, where they're driving down Market Street. Here is some footage of an actual B-roll footage or footage that would be used for rear projections.
Yeah, so but it gives us basically a look at the neon nirvana that Market Street was in 1965. So here we go.
We can't see it.
Can't see it?
Maybe stop the share and try it again.
Okay, let's just try that again.
Hit the boxes. They're hit.
And now it's going?
Perfect.
Okay. Okay, special shout out to Eddie Muller, film historian, for cluing us into that clip. And good night, everybody. Take care.
Good night.
And
good night.
We'll see
you. Bye, all. Thank